The thoughts and opinions of this program are merely those of the host and the guests of the program, and by my opinion, probably nobody else in the entire universe. You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. I'm Jimmy Olsen, and with me is Rooster McRoberts. Rooster, how are you, sir?
I'm doing fantastic, thank you. I had a great weekend. I'm feeling cool as a cucumber.
Well, and we need to after at least the heat that we had in the Midwest last week. That was just insane.
It was hotter here than it was down in Houston, Texas, man. I mean, it was freaking hot. And the humidity, I would walk outside, and I mean, I was just drenched.
Oh,
just drenched.
So
I spent a little time in the pond.
Yeah,
Spent a little time in the pond.
And of course, a lot of people end up putting, which is like us, recording the program today for everyone, doing it with no air conditioning. A lot of air conditioners failing over the weekend.
Oh man, yeah. power around our folks. But of course, folks, power for us ain't no big deal. We light a lot of candles and kerosene lamps McRooster McRoberts. Wow, the heat has got a hold of me. I think I'm having a heat stroke.
Well, between the candles, between the incense, the peppermints, whatever, dude, it all works, right?
Better living through chemicals. Yeah, you betcha, baby. What's going on these days,
man? Well,
what
a lot
in your world.
Not really a lot in my world. I actually had a pretty easy weekend. Didn't really do much of anything, which isn't not always a bad thing. It's nice to have those. So. I know I had a wedding the weekend before, but this past weekend I just kind of relaxed, got a couple walks out. But yeah, you're right. It was a little sticky.
Yeah, it was sticky. Yeah. Like I said, I spent a little time in the pond because I wasn't about to burn up.
It was funny, though, of even how hot it was, of all the people out there with this whole Pokemon Go thing that's still going, which, it's funny. I know we've talked about it before, but there was a guy, I believe it was in New York or something like that, who ended up walking, what was it, like 18 miles? I mean, he's losing weight from doing this.
At the end of the day, if that's what they're doing and they are losing weight, well, God bless them. I mean, that in itself is pretty cool. It's the problem when the employers have to post at their offices, if you walk out of this office trying to find a Pokemon, we're going to fire your ass.
Of course, what I thought was funny was the two kids in Canada who were detained because they accidentally crossed the U.S.-Canadian border as they were trying to find a Pokemon.
That's hilarious. That's hilarious. Do we hold on. Hang on to your hat, man. On to your hat. I got an idea.
Are we going to build a wall, and is Canada going to pay for it?
No. I got an idea.
Okay.
I have figured out how to get rid of all these dadgum illegal aliens.
How's that?
We give them all. Obama's already done it, giving free cell phones away. Let's give them all smartphones.
With Pokemon Go on it,
that they have to do it, and their job is they have to get all the Pokemons, to win, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we, on their phones and their phones only, we make a deal with the guy that started this Pokemon Go thing, where all of the Pokemons for the Mexicans are in Mexico, and for the Canadians are in Canada, and then we'll just shovel their asses out each way, north and south, and we'll solve our problem overnight. That's my answer.
Okay, that's your answer.
Well, it works.
I'm not denying that. You're probably right. It would work. I mean, I can't believe, with where we are here in, because we're doing this in Des Moines, and I know when I'm downtown looking at the sculpture park, it's just insane there. And then the people when I was at Gray's Lake going for my walk over the weekend you're just loaded with these people. But the funny thing is, them looking at their phone and not paying attention and running into everybody because, they're not looking where they're walking and waiting for them to walk right into the lake.
I'm waiting to see the little short clips of people that have their phones out going, I ain't going to be a fool and chase after these Pokemons. And they take pictures of people running into lampposts, right? Or tripping over somebody
funny.
Laying down by the lake, and then fall on top of them or something like that. I'm waiting for all those kind of videos to come out. Those will be a hoot, man.
Those are funny.
Yeah, I'd love that.
This is The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. We are doing this from the DebtProdigy.com studios. DebtProdigy Strategy is the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. You can learn more at debtprodigy.com. You know, something else, Rooster, to talk about over this weekend. I've got a couple things I want to bring up.
Sure.
Something I thought was interesting. First off, so we're just wrapping up the whole Republican National Convention, getting ready for the Democratic National Convention. And, you know, I was thinking over the weekend, and my question is, at this point, because, I mean, I'm sure there's the pop and circumstance for, you know, the people getting the nomination, you know, walking them down the aisle, you know, shooting the confetti, whatever, because that's kind of what we do. And then, but it's not just us. I mean, that's a worldwide thing. I mean, you go in other countries, they all have pop and circumstance. But really, what are the conventions good for this year? Because you're not going to, because the nominee is already there. I mean, here's my thought, and you tell me if I'm right or wrong.
Oh, I'll tell you.
I know you will. So this is going both the Republican and the Democratic conventions that are going on this year. Because, you know, Trump's going in. He's going to be the nominee. Hillary's going in. She's going to be the nominee. So to me, the only people that are actually getting anything out of these conventions this year are the political junkies. And that's on both sides, because I've had some, you know, liberal Democratic friends that were watching the Republican, and there'll be some Republicans watch. So the political junkies, so they get something out of it.
Sure.
The people in the parties to spout their rhetoric just so they can, you know, fluff their own feathers up on stage.
Certainly.
They're going to get something out
Certainly.
Of it. And I think the only other person that's going to get anything out of this is going to be the economy for Cleveland and Philadelphia. Because, well, I mean, all the money that they're dropping by going there.
Especially with the hookers, well, right? No, I'm serious. I mean, there was a huge uptick in the utilization of hookers in Ohio. What does that say about the Republican Party? Says they all horny. That's their problem. But, I mean, certainly did help the economy, didn't it? All right. Look, get off that subject. That is kind of funny. That actually came out that the business was up.
Really, did it?
There's
really?
No pun intended in that either.
So that was actually a serious story that you found. That's funny.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's what they said in Ohio.
Oh, my goodness.
And then the Democrats, they're so stiff and stodgy.
We've got something to talk about on that was released over the weekend, just was crazy too. But one other thing, which of course, you know, this has kind of been swept under the mat now with the whole, you know, Republican National, with the conventions coming and the whole Black Lives Matter. And of course, I know that we were reading about this and no details. And of course, by the time you hear this, there might be some information for it, but another shooting in South Florida, but we don't have any details or anything. But I mean, this is something that I find that's kind of funny. So they come out with this movement, Black Lives Matter, which we talked about before.
Right.
You know, just add it, Black Lives Matter too.
Two.
You know, because everybody matters.
Absolutely.
We are all people, red, yellow, black, and white. We are precious in the sight. I mean, you know, if you are a Christian, Muslim, whatever it is, you know, it's all, you know, you say it's peace and harmony. So that means we all get together. It doesn't matter the color of your skin, the shape of your body, or, you know, what your gender is. We all just need to get along.
Right, right.
But this is what I find funny. So we being a couple white guys, and we would go in and you'll say we try to create a movie, you know, Black Lives something.
Well, I got one.
Black Entertainment Television.
Yeah.
So if we try to do that, somehow we would be called racist, mm-hmm. because we're not. But then if they started, it's okay. Now, we need to, you know, refer to them as African American. So shouldn't this be African American Lives Matter?
Well, I've got a resolution just to create a level playing field.
Okay, what's that?
Well, listen, I mean, this weekend I was talking to a black friend of mine,
mm-hmm.
and he was going, listen, honky.
So honky lives matter.
That's exactly what I think. I'm going to start Honky Lives Matter.
Two.
No. Honky Lives Matter. I'm going to start raising money. I'm going to start sit-ins, stand-ins.
And if you believe
it,
start honking now you are listening to this while you're
driving.
Yeah,
go right ahead. Hey, let's go back. I'm serious. Honky Lives Matter.
Before we head back, thanks to Debt Prodigy for us. It's the good, the bad, and the rooster. Debt Prodigy helps you track all your spending and expenses, create and manage your budget, manage all your financial accounts, and Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including building your home in the shortest amount of time. You can find out more about that at debtprodigy.com as we are recording this at the debtprodigy.com studios. So, all right, Rooster, what is it that you're wanting to go back to?
I want to go back to the conventions again.
Okay,
I mean, all joking aside,
right.
You're right. It's there for the pomp and circumstance. Everything that you said, I think it's there for. But I think additionally, it allows the American public the opportunity to listen to those individuals and get a feel for them. Okay,
I agree with that, but normally you have multiple people still running to get the nomination.
I was getting to that.
Okay,
so you're exactly right. In times past, there could have been two, three different individuals that the delegates in the Republican Party have to say, this is our guy or this is our gal.
Right.
Well, they got nobody to vote against.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously they win. I mean,
right.
Whether it's Trump or Hillary, I mean, it doesn't matter. Both of them win.
Okay.
Right.
Right.
For their respective parties.
Right.
So it's really become more of a confirmation, pomp and circumstance.
Right. Right.
But a confirmation, we confirm him.
Right.
So,
exactly.
So it's a part of the process that's always, virtually always been there. But it's a part of the process of what the Republican Party, the Democratic Party
right.
need to do. And so they're just confirming.
Right.
And that's it. On the outside, it's a damn party.
Right.
Okay, come on, let's just face it.
Yeah, dropping millions of dollars.
It's a big party. And each city gets the revenue from those virtually thousands of people coming in, plus
mm-hmm.
all the networks that are covering it.
Yep.
So the hotels fill up, the restaurants fill up. I mean, it's pretty exciting from that perspective.
On a local level, absolutely.
But what pisses me off in Ohio,
okay,
and I may have said this last week, don't care, I'm going to repeat it again, is Kasich, isn't that how you pronounce his last name, Kasich, Governor Kasich?
Kasich?
Well, listen, look, folks, I'm from Tennessee. You got to give me a little bit of latitude. You know, I can't say some of these names.
Didn't he like run for president or like tried to?
Yeah, he was in the race, dropped out. but look, here's the thing that's bugging me probably
okay.
more than anything else in this whole campaign.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of things that bug me.
Mm-hmm.
But the first thing that bugs me is the little twit. I mean, he's a twit. It's his city, his state.
Right.
And he just backhands his own constituency by not showing up at the convention. Didn't say little bastard had to say a thing.
Right.
But the simple fact that the little twit didn't show up is indicative of what's in his heart. To me, it's like watching my little girl when she was 4 years old getting pissed off in the sandbox.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, if you ain't going to play with me, I'm taking my dadgum toys and go home. And she'd scoop them up and leave.
Mm-hmm.
That's him.
Right.
That's the Bushes. Okay,
mm-hmm.
That's a whole bunch of people.
Well, I mean, Cruz showed up, but that was Cruz too.
Okay, well, I have a real problem with Cruz too.
Well, okay? I mean, he stands right there and says, "Well, I'm not going to," basically, folding his arms and pouting because he said, I mean, again, not saying that Trump was right with what he said. I'm not saying that at all because you shouldn't attack anybody's family. But he's going to go, well, he said something about my mom and my daddy, so I'm not. But what's bad is he signed the pledge that he had to do before even going to taking the stage.
So he didn't keep his word?
Exactly.
Okay.
Actually, what I think is funny is how I think he just totally massacred his political career.
Well,
because people that were following him, as soon as he did that, they're like, are you kidding me?
They're in, again, to continue the problem. That is the problem,
mm-hmm.
is the level of loyalty. Okay.
Right.
I told somebody years ago, I may not agree with everything that you say, and this is a person I respected greatly. Won't
mm-hmm.
mention his name. I will not agree with you all the time, but I promise to always work agreeably
right.
with you. And this is what sends a message across the country and around the globe that we're a bunch of weak suck babies,
mm-hmm.
that when we don't get our way, we grab our toys and run home.
That's right.
Okay. So that's my problem with that. Now, beyond that fact, I've said this before. The political system is an adversarial system. Getting to your point about calling out his wife and his mama and his daddy on Cruz's side and the whole bit and saying that Cruz's daddy had something to do with the JFK shooting and blah, 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 blah. Really? Your little feelings are hurt? Kiss my butt. I mean, at the end of the day, you went into politics understanding that you had to have a very, very thick skin to survive.
Yeah, because it's gotten to the point with the mudslinging, they take the gloves off and they'll just attack whatever they want
look,
to.
There
it's
ain't
ridiculous.
No, look, nothing listen to me, safe. Listen to me. There ain't no mudslinging. There ain't nothing compared to what it was 100 years ago.
Oh, there wasn't mudslinging back then. Back then, they beat you with a cane.
You know what? They'd beat the crap out of you. Andrew Jackson beat you on the steps of the White House. That's a fact.
Right.
The fact is that they went, you don't like it? Boom, I'm going to knock you out.
Right.
The fact is, today, we just got a bunch of words, and we're afraid of the words because we're afraid we're going to hurt ourselves or hurt somebody, and then you're going to crawl up in the fetal position in a corner and cry like a little two-year-old. Words hurt. Really? Seriously? You need a safe place? That's what bugs me. That's the bunch of crybaby pee pants that can't stand up and push the agenda forward. They, in fact, are screwing us on the Republican side. Mm-hmm. We are a weak suck organization and now have pushed everything to the Democratic side, opening the door for individuals to vote for Hillary rather than Trump. Yeah, I understand Trump's a wild card. I get that.
Right.
But we know the details of this broad.
Right.
Okay. I mean, and we know every detail of this broad. And I was trying to find a post that I read the other day with everything that's on there. So at this point,
well, and that'll be our next piece of getting into the Democratic convention, which is
sure.
You know, which is getting
sure.
underway.
We beat up the Republicans.
Well, right, and well, a lot of really interesting things released over the weekend, not making a lot of my Democratic friends happy. We are broadcasting from the Prodigy.com studios. You're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. You can sign up as they're getting ready to launch this fall. You want to do that at DebtProdigy.com. It's a Good, the Bad, the Rooster. I'm Jimmy Olsen with Rooster McRoberts. Okay, so we've been talking about the Republican National Convention, the ridiculousness that had there. I actually did see the video, though, to touch really fast, because we talked about Colbert getting escorted out.
Yeah.
So, because, you know, when we talked about it, it was before he showed it on the on his show. And here's all it was. He got on stage. And have you seen Hunger Games?
Sure.
So you remember
he was dressed up in that pompous.
Yeah. So basically he was doing the Hunger Games, and it was like, you know, here we are. What was it? The power hungry games or something like that. I mean, it was something really. It was stupid.
It was comedy.
It was funny. So now I'm still wondering, you know, if he's going to try something with the Democratic convention, but I haven't heard.
I would not. I wouldn't be surprised if he did. I mean, I would be disappointed if he didn't.
Well, you know, we'll have to see how that rolls through. But of course, I don't know if he has to, because at this point, the Democratic National Convention has just become a comedy show of their own.
Oh, man.
With, again, emails that pop up again. And then now this time, I mean, and I'm sure you've seen it over the weekend or read about it, that the former head of the Democratic National Convention, or, you know, the DNC,
Wasserman,
which ended up stepping down because emails were found that were basically setting things up against Sanders to make sure Hillary was going to get the nomination.
Oh, doesn't that make your head spin?
Oh,
for all those supporters of Bernie that were heading toward Hillary,
right?
I wonder how much that's switching.
Oh, but wait, there's more. So she steps down from the DNC.
Right.
Voluntarily. Okay, great. Which I know there was a lot of, which we've already talked about this a little bit, both sides. You know, Democrats, they were like, you know what? She's given us a bad name. Thank goodness. Get down.
Oh, yeah. It was
out
on my post on Facebook. Had a local radio guy that thinks he's God Almighty going, oh, boy, and he's a Democrat.
Right.
Okay. Oh, fantastic. She's out.
And then within, I mean, I'll say hours, but it might have even been less. But within less than 12, I'll give that.
Less than half a day.
Then Hillary hires her for her campaign. Wait a minute.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Wait a minute.
Look, dude, birds of a feather flock together.
I get that.
Birds of a feather flock together.
Now they are in a uproar.
Oh, sure. 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 So what does that tell us about the Democratic Party?
Absolutely.
You want to piss on our parade or the Republican parade. Let's face it. Democrats got the same problem. They're disjointed, not connected.
This time they are. Normally they get right line.
Yeah. Normally the Democratic Party is very well organized.
Absolutely.
Listen, you got to give them that. It's generally the Republican Party, the old group. Right.
Right. Right.
They're the ones that, we've been here. We're going to be here. You know, type of thing. And the lackadaisical and the way they
do. As you said earlier, the whole thing, I'm going to take my ball and go home. That's not who I wanted, so I'm just not going to vote.
That's it. Well, I had a friend of mine, Brett Rogers, post something on Facebook. He said, the question most Democrats will stumble over, what decision in your life do you trust Hillary Clinton to make for you? Think about that for just a minute. What decision in your life do you trust Hillary Clinton to make for you? Based upon your last, who she just snatched up, brought on board, and I was looking for this whole list of things over her entire career, and if I find it before we're done, I'll read it. But it in itself, I mean, error after error after error. Bill would have her take care of this, failure. Bill would have her when they was in the White House, chair this, failure. The people that she chose ended up having to be fired or tried to go through the vetting process, and they weren't worth it. She was fired as an attorney back in the 70s. I mean, her list of failures is enormous.
What?
And yet they want to try to peg something on Trump, who, guess what? From a political standpoint, they got nothing because he's never been there.
Right.
The second point is now they'll try to dredge up anything from a 13-year-old being raped, which I think is the biggest load of crap in the whole wide world. Okay, I don't believe it. But regardless,
it's out there now. It doesn't matter if it's right or wrong.
Doesn't matter.
Right.
People are going to judge him by that. But Americans, listen to me. Listen to me real, real clear. Big frickin' deal.
Here's what I want.
Big frickin' deal. Let's bring up Benjamin Franklin.
Right.
And juveniles.
Let's bring up this. I want to know, and I don't care which side you're on, when are we going to wake up and realize that someone needs to start holding people accountable for what's going on? Is this two-party system working for us anymore? No. Now, is a multiple-party system the ideal way to go? Well, let's look at, Europe that went to the parliamentary system, which it's still not 100%, but it's one of those things. Basically, when everybody runs, they run, and whoever wins, wins. I mean, they also have a stronger checks and balances because they have a legislative and a executive system. Now, but you have to start the legislative to move into the executive. But if you're in the executive and you're, holding sittings and not getting things done, they immediately boot you out. They don't. Now, is that the right answer? I'm not saying it is or isn't. But there's something out there that we need to look at just for us personally to say, look, if this is a democratic society and if this is a country for the people, by the people, when are we going to look at them and say, you know what, guys, I don't care who you are. Enough is enough.
Well, here's your problem. The underlying issue. Is dollars and cents.
The underlying issues
for politicians is the fact that other than the president, there are no term limits.
I agree with that 100%.
The bottom line is because of that, once they serve one or two terms, if something happens and they want out, they still get a paycheck. I mean, retirement for a politician is the gravy train,
right?
Okay, and so from that perspective, but the further benefit of a politician is the contacts that they made, the PACs, those individuals that support them, that lavish. I know it's illegal, lavish gifts on them, the benefits they get. They leave political office. If they were even half-assed, they're going to be on a speaking circuit tour, getting paid $10,000, $20,000, $30,000, $50,000, $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 for an hour or more.
more.
Or I say, or if you're Bill Clinton, $1 million.
That was
the first one that he ended up receiving as soon as he got out of office.
$1 million. That's exactly right. So the problem in this country is we, the people, have not stood up because we're sheep. Do you hear me? We're sheep. And I think personally that's why the sheep are looking at Trump as much as they are.
Now it makes you wonder how many more are going to end up looking at Trump
after this fiasco over the weekend.
Good or bad? Yeah. I mean, again, it's one of those things.
I think Bernie's group is going to take another look. I think the Young Turks are going to take another look.
And maybe the Democratic, who knows if Bernie doesn't show up and they try and get him, you know, nominated after, who knows? I don't know. You're listening to The Good, The Bad, The Rooster. It is thanks to Debt Prodigy. They help you track all your expenses, spending and expenses, create, manage your budget, manage all your financial account, and Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com for details, which they'll be launching everything in September. So go there and get all the details. So I've got an idea for you, Rooster.
Sure.
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. I'm Jimmy Olsen with Rooster McRobert. So here's my idea. Tell me what you think about this.
Sure.
At this point, everybody's throwing their hat in. So you know what? I think we need to throw our hat in.
Really?
So, hey, I'm thinking President Rooster, Vice President Jimmy.
Okay.
You get your eight ears in.
Yeah.
You get your 8 years in, so you win. We're going to win, and you're going to win a second term. Then
I'm sure of that. Yeah.
Then I'm going to run as president.
Okay.
And then you'll be my vice. We'll just flip-flop it, and then we'll get another 8 years. So we've got our retirement plan for the next 16 years. We're set.
You know, you just brought something up that's really fascinating. I hadn't thought about that.
What's that?
How is that even
possible?
Well, I'm all for it. If we can pull this sucker off, we'll do it. Let me tell you. But how is it? The term conflict of interest really goes through my head right now. That Bill was president, and now his wife can be president.
Right. Well, but what would be the difference is, you know, like, you know, Obama finishing and they were trying to get Biden to take in. I mean, I know he was vice president.
But the head doesn't press the same pillow. OK.
OK. Right.
Well,
right.
Maybe it doesn't. I have heard. We won't go down that road.
So you're talking husband and wife. So husband has been president. Now wife is going to be president.
Yeah. Yeah. And so he has some specifical. That was good. Some tie-ins with people and relationships. To further, and let's, again, going back to the Clinton fools that they are, crooks that they are, I can see a lot going on. And there's somewhere in my head, I can't put a finger on it, but it's somehow a conflict. To me, it's a conflict of interest.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't put a finger on it, but it feels that way.
Right.
And generally, when I feel this way, it's true. You know, that there's
it's an interesting point to bring up. I mean, what's funny is people have been talking about, you know, the Clintons being in the White House again, but this time being the other way around. I mean, we know that Bill can't run again because they have the term limits. You get two terms and you're done. I mean, you can't go back.
Yeah. And here's the thing. The Clintons were never very popular in the White House. I mean, there have been books and articles written about Secret Service never being treated so poorly.
Trump was a huge fan.
Yeah. Yeah. But get my point. Get my point.
Right.
Listen, getting back to Trump. Trump, look, here's the thing with Trump that everybody needs to get out of their head and forget about. Because it's not an issue. Well, he bankrupt four or five. But yeah, so what?
Legally,
he's a businessman,
right?
Okay,
exactly.
There are people in this city that you can mention my name to, and 9 out of 10 of them go, he's a real asshole,
right?
And it's exactly what they're going to say, and that's all right. But I guarantee they'll come back around and go, you know what? But he's shrewd,
right?
He's a businessman. He understands how to make things happen. Look, that's Trump. Trump's a businessman. Everybody wants to bring up he was talking to the Clintons. He must have been buddy-buddy. Look, he is buddy-buddy with whoever's ass is next to him that's going to help him further his business positions.
He's building buildings, which means you have to work the political battle there on a local to state level.
And sometimes national, even for those buildings.
Right.
That's the thing. That's all he did. He's going to tell you
in business whatever needs to be told.
Speaking of business, win or lose, this has been fantastic for the Trump empire.
I got to think so.
Let's be honest. No. Let's look at it.
Yeah.
You know what? Here's why. And I was talking about this. I was thinking it was maybe you and I, but I guess it was. A friend and I were talking about this over the weekend. Fantastic for the Trump empire. Because during his traveling, he's using the Trump jet, which they are renting. He is staying at Trump hotels where there are Trump hotels. Of course, he also, you know, the whole bank on yourself, loaned himself $20 million that they have to pay back with interest to him. Again, all legal, nothing. This has been huge.
Well, certainly.
So again, the brand, he wins either way.
Oh, yeah. The brand has been accentuated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? The brand has improved.
Right.
But here's, and you're absolutely right. The point I was getting to, though, is all of these things, to me, are refreshing.
Right.
And what I mean by refreshing is I'm happy he's not a political insider.
Right. I look at it this way. Being a businessman, which you're going to know because you are, you know, if a businessman is going to screw you, all you have to do is have your eyes open and watch, because you can you can normally, if they're a true blue businessman, shrewd, you can tell when something's going to come.
Well, let me give you an example.
For the most part.
Yeah, for the most part. But let me give you an example. Mm-hmm. Look, I guarantee in deals that are made, there's always a contract.
Right. Absolutely.
Okay?
Absolutely.
And the party that's drafting the contract doesn't withhold that contract until the final minute so that the other person needs to sign and agree to the contract, signs it. Both parties read the contract.
Mm-hmm.
Both parties have attorneys that read the contract.
Mm-hmm.
You know, years ago, I did a contract with a guy, and he defaulted on it. I sued him. I won. And he said, Goodwin screwed me. I got screwed. No, you didn't.
Again, like I said,
no, you
if
didn't.
He's going to, in their world, guess what? They can't do it.
We had a contract.
Because it's got to be in your, you have to disclose
that's
everything.
The point. So the problem is the fool broke the contract.
Right.
He had the contract.
Right.
All the judge had to do was read the contract.
Absolutely.
And it was done. So don't say that Trump is a bad guy based upon that, because he isn't. He's a shrewd businessman, and to be respected for that.
So it goes back to your eyes being wide open because you read the contract.
Absolutely.
You know what's going to happen.
Absolutely.
Now, let's look at the debacle that just happened over the weekend.
Sure.
Where you and there's been story after story after story, and I don't care which side of the fence you're on, because I've heard stories on both sides.
Sure.
Republican, Democrat, I've heard stories on both sides. So now we're dealing with somebody who will do something behind your back, because there is no contract to read to go, well, what are you doing?
Well, obviously not. Yeah, exactly. Killary's going to be pulling shenanigans right and left, Joe Shenanigan. I mean, he's going to pull crap too. I want Trump because I know what he's going to do. He does not hold back.
My question goes back to us going running for president.
All right, let's do it. All right.
When as a country are we going to throw the flag and call a technical? When?
Well, we should have done that years ago.
But
the simple fact is, it makes one wonder why 14 states in this country have banded together and have created militia units prepared to overthrow the government. 14 states have done that. Thankfully, three of my loving states, which is Tennessee, Kentucky, and Texas, are obviously on the list. And the biggest group, guess which state the biggest group has?
Montana.
Very funny. Texas. Texas.
Well, that's where all the bunkers are. You know, all the militias are, you know, up in the mountains.
Let me tell you something. It is getting bad enough.
Right.
Well,
you had Texas wanting to secede from the union. I mean, there's been other states talking the exact same thing. I mean, it's no different than what has just happened over in Europe with, you know, with England Britain succeeding from the European Union.
European Union.
Well, I mean, again, when is it going to be that we look at this and go, enough is enough. When are we going to get a backbone as a people? Or are we too busy being coddled, too busy sitting here like, you know, two old guys ranting and whining about what's going on because we can and you're going to listen? Thank you very much, by the way. I mean, we're just having fun doing this. But the thing is, let's be real about this. When are we going to stand up, have a backbone, and go, I'm done. I can't deal with this. You're bleeding me. I can't be bled anymore.
You know, I don't have an answer for that other than to say we are still sheep being led to the slaughter. And how many people out of 300, 400 million people in this country, whatever that number is, you have to look at. It has to be a state by state.
Which the way change. It should be anyway.
Well, that's the way government's
you way start local. Works. Local
right.
goes to state. State goes to region. Region goes to national. I mean, it all starts with.
Let me read something to you. Our Constitution.
Okay.
And this is again from my friend Brett, and he has a picture of this on his Facebook post. This is not a list of my rights. This is a list of limits on the federal government, getting back to what you said, and pushing it to the state level. God gave me my rights. My rights can't be counted or listed or limited. The problem is nobody's understanding what the Constitution is there for and is supposed to provide to us. It is our guidelines. Mm-hmm. It is our infrastructure.
Right.
Okay. It's our piece of paper that was designed to keep everybody kind of honest.
Right.
You know, levels of integrity.
Right.
And I'm not talking about their moral integrity.
Right.
I'm not talking about their drinking integrity.
Right.
I'm not talking about even their business integrity.
Right.
I'm talking about their downright love for the opportunity to have their own country where they could have those freedoms on the level of you and I and not have a government that has grown to a level that it is mama and we're supposed to be sucking off its tit. Okay.
Right.
That's the problem in this country. All right. That everybody wants to be feeding off of it.
Right.
That wasn't what the government was designed to do. It was designed to keep our infrastructure together. And if, and this, there's other, somebody's going to come back and say, but you forgot this. You forgot. Well, I get that. But my point is, smaller government, more control on the state level. And then at that point, Bubba, here's the deal. Then if the federal government starts getting a little bit too jumpy frog and they want to do some stuff, then each state could go, no, I'm not going to have it. Put our foot down.
Right.
Say it's Texas and say, we ain't a part of this program. We don't like your party and we don't want to come play at your party.
Well, and the thing is, we've given that power to the state, and I've had conversations with
the Constitution gave that power to the state.
I'm going to say, going back to the comment that you said of basically living off the government taking care of us, which is socialism.
You didn't say it like I did, but it's okay.
Well, right, but the line I'm going down to of saying of us giving the power to the government to take care of us is because there are. Again, with my beliefs, because, you know, I'm being a spiritual kind of person, that those that are to take care of the welfare, you know, taking care of the poor, the destitute, the, you know, the orphans, the widows, the those that are sick, that is a spiritual responsibility, not a government responsibility.
Amen. That's right. That's
and
exactly
I don't
right.
care if you are Christian. I don't care if you are Jew. I don't care if you are Muslim. I don't care who you are. But if you believe that we are to live in harmony and that if we need to love our neighbors, that means we need to have compassion and to take care of them, which then it's our responsibility to take care of our neighbor, not the government's responsibility to take care of them. So what we have done is basically step back and said, you know what? I'm lazy. I'm going to just be selfish and think of myself, screw you. I don't care if you're dying or whatever. I'm just going to walk over you and keep going to where now We've left it into the hands of the government, which it's not their responsibility. The federal government, their job is to keep our federal borders secure. That's the federal government's job. The state government's job is to keep our state borders secure.
There you go.
Our local government is to keep our local borders secure.
It was designed to do just that.
And then as us being of the human race, I'm not even going to say Americans, just being human. The human race, it doesn't matter what your, you know, a friend of mine, we're actually having this, you know, conversation, they're calling everything racial. Well, no, we're all part of the human race. It's not, it's
the human
race. It's the ethical difference, not ethical, but the ethnic differences. It's not the races. So it's our job, our responsibility as the human race to take care of other humans.
Simply put, Jimmy, it's I should have the right to decide if I'm going to feed you tomorrow because I know you're hungry.
Right.
But I also have a kind of a moral obligation to do that.
Doesn't matter if you like me or hate me.
That's exactly. As a good human being, you're not a bad person. Mm-hmm. I should feel in my heart that that's the right thing to do. But by God, government, president, that group, Don't you dare force down my dadgum throat the fact that I've got to pay out of my pocket for this, that, and the other, whether it's Obamacare or anything else. I don't feel that it's right to be done that way. In fact, it makes me think of a movie, Ms. Kirby, you might see if you can find it. It was a Jimmy Stewart movie, and he had like six boys and a couple of girls, and his wife had passed away, and it was the Civil War was starting.
Mm-hmm.
And his little short speech that he made.
Was that with the Mr. Smith Goes to Washington or something?
No. Okay. This was, he was a farmer and had and one of his boys said, we need to get into this fight. But his comment, his short few lines, I wish I could play it for you, but it's telling.
Mm-hmm.
It clearly identifies what should happen in government. And from his perspective, it was, this is not my war.
Right.
This is my property. These are my boys.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just come in here and take them from me.
Right.
We've turned this ground by the sweat of our brow and in our hands. Mm-hmm. What we grow here, we eat here. What we raise here, we eat here.
Mm-hmm.
This is our land, not yours.
Right.
And I can't remember what the name of it was, but you want to go to a break real quick, and I'll let you know.
This land is your land. This land is my land. You are listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. I know we're getting close to the end of our segment for this week, but it's made possible by Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home or business finances on autopilot. You can get more details at debtprodigy.com, which, again, they're going to be launching here in September. And you can find out more details about that to help yourself to, you know, again, become self-sufficient so you don't have to rely on others. I mean, outside of, you know, a neighbor that, you know, again, you know, love your neighbor, love your enemy. It doesn't matter. Like you or hate you. If you're hungry, if you're hurt, you're right. There's a moral obligation I need to take care of.
Yeah, let me tell you something. You're on the side of the road and something's wrong with you. I ain't going to ask you what your religious position is.
No.
I don't care what the color your dadgum skin is.
Right.
I don't care if you just robbed a bank. I'm not going to ask those questions because I don't know which question to ask. I'm going to attend to your needs.
Mm-hmm.
The rest will get sorted out. But I'm going to be a good human being and be there for you. That's the key. The movie that I was talking about, Shenandoah.
Okay,
Shenandoah, great movie. Of course, I'm an old Western type fan anyhow.
So if you haven't seen it, look it up. I mean, I'm sure you could probably find it on YouTube. You probably even find the speech that you're talking about on YouTube.
Yeah, just one sort of Confederate colonel rode in and wanted to engage his procure Jimmy Stewart's boys, and he said no. Now, his boys had a different attitude.
Right.
I will tell you, as some of them did, a different attitude. And the attitude is, Paul, it's getting right to up to our front door. We got to be a part of it. That's okay, too.
Mm-hmm.
That's okay, too. But it's his decision.
Right.
Not his father's.
Right.
Okay. It's his decision, not the government's.
Right.
Okay. From that perspective. Now, that opens up another can of worms that somebody's going to ask. But my point in that is that it should be we can take care of our own.
Right.
As far as that goes,
and we
take
need
care
to.
Of our own. Yeah, we do.
Absolutely.
As
Rooster and I take care of each other.
That's just a little warping, sick and twisted.
But anyway, that does it for this week. Rooster, thank you very much, sir.
You bet.
Always a lot of fun.
Pleasure.
It's the good, the bad, and the rooster. We'll chat a little more next week. Probably a little more political than what our original plan was for the past couple weeks. But, it's. I mean, just, man, a lot of crazy
called
stuff is
it.
Going on.
Called for it. Let me give you the word for the day again.
Cock-a-doodle-doo?
No.
Oh, that's
no.
three words, though, isn't
no,
it?
No. Bottom feeders. Bottom feeders. I see them all over Facebook, bottom feeders. Just looking.
Yeah.
Just looking for something they can pick at that scab to make them feel better. Well, let me tell you about my next-door neighbor. They had this problem, that problem. You know.
Or we call them ambulance chasers.
Ambulance chasers, bottom
catfish,
feeders. Bottom,
shrimp, lobster,
They're bad. They're just all bad. So all you bottom feeders out there that are gaining a great deal of satisfaction by bringing down somebody else, grow up. Grow up. That's all I got for this week.
You are listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. I'm Jimmy Olsen, Rooster McRoberts. It's made possible by Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy helps you track all your spending and expenses, create a manager budget, manage all your financial account, and Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com, and we are in the DebtProdigy.com studios. So until next time, thank you for listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster.